Good morning. Welcome. So glad to see you this morning. Welcome to our early service, our 9 a.m. worship service here at First United Methodist Church, Marble Falls. A welcome to those of you who are watching at home this morning or even viewing this at a later time. We're thankful that you're also with us. We have a few little announcements this morning. I just would like to draw your attention to the bulletin, and in it, as you know, there's a calendar of events. If that affects you, please take a look at it, and some other boxes of important information. One thing I need to say this morning is, in light of things that are happening health-wise and pandemic-wise in our world, and we know that the CDC has put out some different guidance this past week, and we're working with that. Our Safety and Security Committee is meeting this week, our Safety and Security team, and we're going to rework how we're doing things in here, and they're following the directions of our county medical officer, Dr. Madrigal. So we just want to just let you know that that's all working, and we'll see how things develop. We're just thankful for the changes that are taking place, though, and the fact that we can more and more gather to worship together and be close to each other. Remember that in your bulletin is a communications card. It's perforated. You can tear it off and place it in one of the white boxes as you leave this morning. Please do that. Register your attendance. Let us know you are here. And also, if you have a prayer request or other information you would like to pass on to the pastors, put that on there, because we look at these, all of us look at these, every week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and we pray over them and we pray for you. So I would just encourage you in that way. One final reminder, tomorrow evening is our monthly prayer and healing service. It begins here at 6 p.m. It's a small, very informal service where we pray with each other and for each other. We lay hands on those that wish to be prayed for, and we anoint with oil for those that would like that. It's a very deeply spiritual service, and we invite you to come even if you just want to sit and just be in a room full of spiritual feeling and prayer. We invite you for that tomorrow evening, 6 p.m. I think with that, that's all the announcements that I have. Is there anything else, Pastor Ellen? No? Okay. Well, with that then, let's begin our morning worship service with prayer and music.
All right. Let us pray. Father God, I thank you so much for this day, Lord, and I pray that we don't waste this day. I pray that we don't waste any moment, Lord. I thank you for inviting us in, Lord, into your will, into your ways, Lord. I pray that you teach us to be more like you, teach us to love the way you love, Lord. I pray that our eyes can see the way you see, that we can be useful and beneficial to your will. Lord, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for being a God of love and laughter and joy and a giver of peace and a giver of healing. Lord, I pray that even as our world and, globally and locally, things are just so upside down and can easily be overwhelming to us. Thank you for being a God of victory, Lord. And I pray that even this morning as we sing and declare your goodness, that we can be reminded in our hearts and in our minds that you've got this. You've won. You're victorious. You are the superhero, the only one, Lord. And I pray that this time can be meaningful, that we can hear from you as we sing about you and as we learn about you. In the strong name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. All right, and I do invite you to have a little fun. In fact, the first words to the song we're about to sing are going to be oh, 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 oh. Maybe one more oh. us in the Spirit's power. Our hearts are beating for you now. We will go. We will go. You send us with the light of love. All the darkness breaking up, and we will go. Generation to fall on our knees and call for the nations. Send us out, Lord. Send us out. You are the truth, the light, and salvation. Shine a light with this declaration. Send us out, Lord. Send us out. Let's hear those woes. Holy fire, there's passion burning deep inside, and we will go, we will go. Now is the time for our generation to fall on our knees and call for the nations. Send us out, Lord, send us out. The truth, the light, and salvation. Shine your light with this declaration. Send us out, Lord. Send us out. And though the need is great, our God is greater. And though the need is great, our God is greater. And though the need is great, our God is greater. Though the need is great, our God is greater. Though the need is great, you God are greater. Though the need is great, you God are greater. Now's the time. Now is the time for our generations to fall on our knees. Call for the nations. Send us out, Lord. Send us out. You are the truth, the light, and salvation. Shine your light with this declaration. Send us out, Lord. Send us out. Send us out, Lord. Send us out. One more time.
Distant shores and the islands will see your light. and you will receive whatever you need. You said, "Bring now here from heaven, and I'll heal it.
Seated.
How's it going, friends? If there are any children, I would love to invite the children to come down in children's time. If not, that's okay. I still have a box with some treats that might be fun. Actually, I don't know if there's treats in here. There usually is.
Maggie's coming.
Oh, thank you so much for coming down, Maggie. I'm very excited for children's time.
Hi.
Hi.
Come on down.
I got a spot right here for you.
What's your name?
I didn't hear you, buddy. What was it? Jordan?
Truitt.
Hey, how's it going? You want to sit down right here with me? You can stand. That's fine. We're getting ready to talk about things that we do not know, and I grew up on the beach, and my dad wasn't very handy, so I have a bunch of tools here, and I have no clue how to use them, and I'm going to be embarrassed, so I was wondering if you guys could help me figure out what they are. Do you know what this is? It's, what'd you say?
Screwdriver.
It is a screwdriver. What do you do with a screwdriver? I think you do something with screws.
Your dad builds cabinets.
I have all sorts of things here. This one was real interesting. I think I know how this one works, but I'm not sure what I would do with it.
Put two pieces of wood in between.
I was told I could put two pieces of wood together, and it would be tightened together. That is awesome. Have you ever seen one of these? It's heavy. This one I thought was really interesting. Do we have any idea what this is? This draws chalk lines. Have you ever played with chalk? I love to play with chalk in the front yard. But I think this would looks a little bit different. It's blue. I'll try not to get blue on the carpet. This one I thought was really interesting. It looks like scissors, but it has all of these numbers on it. I think I know how to use it, but I don't know exactly what it's for. Oh, it says it right here. It says wire stripper. Man, I have all of these things here that I know how to use, but I don't know what they're used for. Kind of reminds me what we're going to talk about in church. Because God is here with us, and he's taught us how to do things, like how to sing songs, how to love, how to forgive. But we don't know exactly what that's going to be like. But God is going to give us opportunities to go to all of the world. It's kind of like when Jesus was with his first disciples in the book of Acts, and he says, I'm going to send you out, and all you need to do is be my witness. So we already know what to do, which is just smile and love. Yeah.
You're part of it, Truett.
Yeah. And all we got to do when we go out there is do the things that we've learned in here, even if, like these tools, we don't know exactly how we're going to be used. It's kind of scary to do unknown things, isn't it? Well, why don't we pray for that time? And when we pray, we like to close our hands and close our eyes and repeat after what I say. And then it becomes our words and to God. Okay?
Dear Jesus,
thank you for loving us.
Thank you
for teaching me many things.
I know
that you've called me to do things.
Help me
be brave
as I do them.
In Jesus' name,
amen.
Yay, Jesus! Thank you.
Awesome. Here comes Miss Sally Best to talk to us for our ministry moment today. Thanks, Sally.
Thank you, Rick, for getting this going. I don't know if y'all know, but Rick is Maggie's favorite person in the church. Thanks for all you do. I would say it's y'all, but y'all aren't Rick. So this morning we heard in our music team song that now is the time, send us out to go out into the world. But guess what? The world is right here in our church in a few weeks. We have Vacation Bible Blast coming up. It is, now the best do a lot of fun things, and we travel and do a lot of fun things, but Vacation Bible School is truly one of our favorite weeks out of the year. It is such a time of renewal in our faith. It is the busiest and loudest time of renewal of our faith, but we love it so much. You have the opportunity to serve June 1st through the 4th from 9 to 12, probably a little before that and a little after that, but I promise we're going to take really good care of you while you're here. But you can do this. I know a lot of you are thinking, oh, I've done that, Sally. I've already served. I taught Sunday school or VBS or whatever, and that's awesome. That means you're already qualified and that you have experience, and we need you. We need you again. You've had a whole year of rest, right? So you're ready. You're ready. That's so exciting. We had a whole year of forced rest. So the kids are going to be really excited, and we are so excited to fill the church again with these kiddos, because so many of them that are going to be here don't have Jesus in their home. This may be the only time we get to work with them. And I will tell you right now, you can tell by just watching us come in, that even the ones that have Jesus in their home, they still need you here too. So anyway, hold on, I'm going to get a really good look at y'all. Like a really, really good look. I'm going to have to look over here again, I think. Yeah. Because it looks like there's a few Eddie Haskells, former Reformed Eddie Haskells, Dennis the Menace, and Ramona Geraldine Quimby's in here. Because y'all weren't perfect, were you? No, you weren't. So yes, VBS is loud. VVB is loud. It's wild. And yeah, the kids are unruly, and maybe they're a little more unruly than they have been in the past. But you know what that means, right? They need us even more. They need us even more. Maybe you're just finished up with something and you're exhausted. But you know what? God will provide. He'll provide all the energy and strength you need to volunteer. We have so many opportunities. There is the perfect space for you. God has already gone before and ordained what that would be. Whether it's, you may not be like me, who wants to be in the classroom with the kiddos, because that is the best place to be. And you will have to pry the crafts area out of my cold, dead hands one day, because that is what I want to do with those kids every year. I've told them that. I don't make many requests or call rank on anything, but I do on that one, because I love to be interacting with the kids. And if that's not your thing, that's okay. There's snacks. There's transportation. There's safety. There's registration. There's so many ways that you can serve. If you can't physically be here to serve, Pastor Clay has suggested the opportunity of fasting and praying every Saturday prior to VBB. So you have that. For me, I'll be here serving, because I don't want to fast and pray every Saturday prior to VBB. So let's contact Stephanie. There's a registration table out front. And if you've been waiting to be asked, guess what? It just got done. So I can't wait to see you and see how you're going to serve. And thank you so much. Thanks for all you're doing to get us ready, Stephanie.
Real fast, I know co-teaching sounds terribly scary and we still need co-teachers, but all that means is that you walk 10 kids in a pod around to snacks, crafts, games. Super easy. You make friends, you have like your people in those pods, like first we'll transfer with first, second would transfer with second graders. So co-teacher sounds scary, like you're teaching, but don't worry, Mark and the Skits team, Alan, they're gonna teach your kids for you. So you just have to walk around with these precious fun kids. If you want crafts, if you want snacks, whatever area you are excited to serve in, please know that I will honor that. I want you to serve where you feel you best fit. That's my goal. Uh-huh. I don't want you serving somewhere where you think you're going to be miserable. But don't freak out about co-teaching. It's not quite what it sounds. It's just moving kids from one place to the other, 10 of them, and you're with other helpers who are also moving 10 kids. So you're never alone, y'all. Okay? Yay, Jesus.
Yay, Jesus.
Yay, Jesus. We will be out there after. So, and if you have kids, send them to Kids Church right now. We're headed that direction.
Thank you, Miss Stephanie. Thank you, Sally. I've never heard such a persuasive argument for volunteers for Vacation Bible School. But if you missed it, or if you would like to see it again, sort of, there's a video on the church Facebook page that Sally did that's great. And so go to our Facebook page and check it out. Brothers and sisters, this is the time in our service when we used to pass the offering plates, and we probably will be doing that again soon. But until that time, there are some beautiful boxes out in the foyer. You can leave your gifts in today, your tithes and your offerings. And I know that those will be appreciated and used to glorify God through the ministries of this church. That's a wonderful opportunity for us. There's also a little piece of paper here called the communication card. If you would fill that out, and it has a perforated thing, just tear that off. There's another box for that out there, so we would appreciate that as well. It's a wonderful opportunity to be in worship. We learned that being away from one another is not easy. And so today we're here and we're together, And I am so thankful for the Best Family, for Vacation Bible Blast, for children's volunteers in your pews today, or little hand-decorated cards from our midweek ministry that we call Block Party. And those cards are for encouragement. If you know someone who really is in need of encouragement this week, take one of those and give it to them, okay? And let them know the children of this church decorated them. If you didn't, pray over it and leave it for someone else to find later. I'm thankful for the ministries of our children with Block Party and Vacation Bible Blast and Sunday school that starts at 6 months in this church. I've never been to a church where Sunday school starts at 6 months. But I'm thankful for all of our children's ministries, and when I'm thankful, I say, thanks be to God. Friends, let us pray. Gracious and mighty God, I ask that you be with us today as we worship you. Help us to tune out of our minds all the things that we're thinking about for this afternoon or this week, or what our agenda is, or what we have to do when we get out of church. Instead, oh God, help us to tune all of that out and to tune only into your Spirit. Open our ears. Help us to breathe deeply of your Spirit. Thank you for the gift of worship. As someone said earlier when I was visiting, we never realized how precious a church was until we couldn't go there. So I'm so thankful that we can do that. I'm so thankful for those, oh God, who are online and watching with us this morning. Simulcast is a great gift. We thank you for the rain that has fallen, oh God, and the rain that is promised in the coming week. But Lord, no drama, please. Can we just have nice, life-giving rain, like what I drove into to the church this morning? That pleasant shower of your blessings that perks the grass up and makes the streams run. We pray, oh God, for the situation in the Middle East. We're told in Scripture that the Holy Spirit intercedes with us with sighs too deep for words, so that when we don't know what to pray, we merely ask the Holy Spirit to guide us. And that situation is so complicated in the Middle East, oh God. We know that the Spirit is interceding. Help us to be faithful in doing that as well. We ask, oh God, that you bless those who grieve today. As we had a memorial service on Friday, and we have another one this coming Thursday. And many other families, as they grieve, oh God, comfort them in the way that only you can do. We pray, oh God, for those dealing with chronic illness of some kind, whether it's cancer or whether it's a pulmonary issue or whether it's COVID, or Lord, may your healing power be made manifest in exactly the way that you intend. We thank you for that in advance. Lord, we pray for all graduates, high school and college. As I keep seeing on Facebook, all of these students graduating from universities, from Tarleton and A&M and University of Texas and all of these places, Lord, thank you for the gift of perseverance, because we remember sometimes what that was like. And we pray your blessings upon the graduates, that they receive their degrees and they're ready to go out and serve. Thank you, oh God, for loving us. Be with us now as we lift up names that are on our hearts this morning. Oh God, for all of those lifted verbally and for those that remain in the silence of our hearts, we lift them before you and we thank you in advance for what you're doing, what you're going to do, what you have done. We thank you most of all for your Son, our Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Before I read the scripture, I do want to echo what Sally said, which is I understand that volunteering for Vacation Bible School is maybe something that not all of us are called to, but I do believe prayer and fasting is something, if medically allowed to fast, are a part of. So I'm serious. I'm going to really call us for moments of Saturday, see it in the upcoming emails, because I want this week to be bathed in a special type of prayer that I see that I don't think just ends in the book of Acts in our scripture. I think God still calls us to do that. With that announcement done, let us get to the scriptures. This is Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 11. Hear these words. So when they had come together, they asked him, Jesus, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom of Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of sight. While he was going and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. This is the word of God for the people of God. I will admit, when I was reading this scripture and I was thinking about the conversation that the early disciples were having with Jesus, I couldn't help but think of one of my favorite memes. A meme, if you're not familiar with that technology or with that phrasing, is something you might have experienced on social media. It is a picture and text below it. In this particular case, it is one of those memes that may not be historically accurate, but I still really like it. It is one of Henry Ford. And it says, if I would have asked the customer what they liked, they would have said, I wanted a faster horse. Henry Ford did not invent the automobile, but he engaged the automobile for the masses. That quote actually comes from the inventor of the mega cruise ship. So there's some truth of a captive industry coming up with that phrase, but despite what the meme says, from my understanding, Henry Ford never said that. Why I think about that is because if Jesus would have asked the disciples what the kingdom would have been like, the answer is prevalent in this text. Please make it just like when David was king. Get me a faster horse. Restore the kingdom of old. The disciples aren't told in detail exactly what's going to go on or what's going to happen, but Jesus still makes the claim, by not really answering their question, that their call is to be a witness to all of the world. To those who share a common identity, to those who are similar but may not be the most liked, and of course to people from all over the earth. Jerusalem, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. The story continues, and Holy Spirit and Jesus comes up and is lifted through the sky. The next part of the story is they take Judas's example, and the next story is the story of Pentecost. Where this idea comes into is this comes right after this, and there seems to be a lot of unknown going on. As we're talking about things that we're springing into, that is what we're doing. We are springing into the unknown. Because I feel often one of the things that stops us from maybe living out this going into Jerusalem, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth is because there's not a lot of questions answered. In my years of ministry, I've noticed that if I were to plan a trip to the end of the earth with an itinerary and a destination, I will get more volunteers And then if I say, let's go to a neighborhood or a nursing facility and just pray. It seems like we are very easily engaged, and I know I am when I know exactly what's going to go on. I'm scared to do things when I don't know what the next steps are. And I'll admit that sometimes I feel tempted when the Holy Spirit is calling us into something that we do not know. I have a temptation to answer all of the questions to increase participation. But in my times of moment in prayer, I really feel like maybe God is calling us to go somewhere where we don't know all the answers quite yet. Maybe things look a little bit different. But that doesn't mean that we're not prepared. And that doesn't mean that we don't have any practice. It just means we may not have all of the answers. I don't always quote movies, as you know. I try to find food metaphors or personal stories. But as I was pondering this idea that God has us equipped to do something that we do not know, I could not get this piece of classical cinema out of my mind. 37 years ago, one of the greatest movies ever made came out, The Karate Kid. The Karate Kid is this phenomenal film in which a young boy, David, is asked or gets the opportunity to train for a karate tournament. And there was a remake of this for the younger folks that came out about 10 years ago in 2012, and there's a really cool Netflix series set in this universe. But perhaps the most memorable scene of this great movie, both the old and the new one, is when the young disciple shows up frustrated. And the young disciple says, I want to know what it means to be karate. You've only taught me how, in the 84 version, to wax on, wax off, to paint, and to sand. The new one, he puts a coat on, a coat rack, and takes it off. And I want to learn karate. And there's a moment in which he shows him that the work that he was really doing was actually preparing him with muscle memories for the things that would go on. That waxing on and off actually taught him karate. Now, I want that image and that idea that he did not know what he was doing, but he actually did. And I'm here to tell you guys, that's what happens when we do church together in this building. When we sing songs, when we go to Sunday school, when we go to meetings in the week and prayer meetings, we are waxing on and waxing off. We are developing the skills that we may not know exactly how they come, but I promise you God is going to use that spiritual memory in opportunities and things that we do not know. We read here in the book of Acts. The book of Acts is, if you do not know, your Bible actually isn't arranged in chronological order. It's a collection of 66 books that are kind of separated by genre. And in this particular case, the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts are actually written by the same person. I like to think of them as part one and part two. You'll notice they begin very similarly, and here we are reading at the very beginning of part two. And in the story of Scripture, there is a huge sense of unknown. There has been a huge shift. Things have completely changed, but they're getting ready to change even more, and God is finding ways to do new things. I relate to that moment in Scripture, to that moment of time that we are in now. Because I have observed that as we go out, that all of the things that happen in part two, the story of the church, aren't exactly planned out in the first part of the Gospel of Luke. I hear lots of stories about Jesus hanging out with his disciples. I hear about him fishing. But I never hear about him teaching them how to give a good sermon. But here, in a couple of verses, what does Peter do? He gives a sermon about Pentecost. I read nowhere in the Gospels in which Jesus incorporates and teaches them what to do if you encounter an Ethiopian eunuch. But he taught them how to wax on and wax off. So when Philip encounters someone a little bit different, he knows exactly what to say and so forth. I think, at least this might be reflecting on my own heart, but I think it's some for some of us here, that when we're hesitant to go out into Jerusalem, it's because of the fear of the unknown. Sometimes I'm like, God, just tell me who you want me to talk to and exactly what you want to say, and I'll do that. I used to make cold calls for sales. Like, I can talk to anyone if you tell me what you want. But sometimes God tells me to go to a place and to listen. If Henry Ford asked people what they wanted, they would have said a faster horse. If David would have asked Mr. Miyagi what he wanted, Mr. Miyagi would have asked Daniel what he wanted, Daniel would have said, teach me how to karate chop. When I read the book of Acts and I read the scripture, it does lean us to a bit of unknown. It asks us to go out and to witness, to go to Jerusalem, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. The disciples approached Jesus and they said, when will you restore the kingdom? And I think they had a good heart in mind. I think they had images of scripture, like maybe Zechariah chapter 8, verse 22, or Isaiah chapter 60, verse 3, in which these prophets display an image of people coming to them. And there is an aspect of that. VBS will be a place where people come to us. But I think Jesus was sitting there in a reminder that the new kingdom isn't centered around people coming to us, but us going to people. So I might propose this question, and this is something that the people called Methodists, the history in which we are involved in, at one time was sort of the thing that we did. We went west in America when no one else did. We went places before there was buildings. Preachers just needed one of these. And they would go to a place and talk. I hope we can relearn both the spirit in the book of Acts and the spirit of our own history and to go to these places. So I might want to exercise here in our closing thoughts, what is your Jerusalem? That is the first step. What is your Samaria? And what might be the ends of the earth? I don't know if this metaphor works well, but I used to use it when I was in city context. I used to say, your Jerusalem is where you go to your gas station, where you like to fill up your gas, and everyone else who fills up your gas at that place, that's probably your neighborhood, and that's probably your Jerusalem. Where is the Samaria once you've reached that place? Well, we may not do quite like they read in the scriptures and completely avoid a town as we travel through, but some of us might avoid a gas station in a certain part of town or a certain town. Maybe that's your Samaria. And then, of course, to the ends of the earth. And for all of us, it might be different. We are a church that draws from all over the Highland Lakes. Your Jerusalem is your neighborhood. It is your gas station, which is probably not the same as my gas station, though it might be. I think sometimes if I asked people what they wanted, they might say, I want people to come to me. I want a faster horse. I want to learn how to karate chop. I can't deny what I feel like God is telling me. God is saying our job is to go to Jerusalem. Our job is to go to Samaria. And our job is to go to the ends of the earth. Which I think is Austin. I don't know. Is that Austin? But I do want to say this. We are not going unprepared. I honestly and truly believe that what we do here on Sundays, the songs that we sing, the Bible studies that we attend, these are the moments that are preparing us. We have the skill sets. We have the tools. We just have to lean out and go. We have been preparing for this, some of us, our whole life. God has called us to go be a witness to people who we do not know. There are people who do not know that God loves them. And there are people that we do not know that God does. There will be a moment in which both of those unknowns become known. There's people that God knows that we don't, and we're going to get to know them. And there's people that God knows that don't know God, and they will get to know them. Came really close. For the people who will get that known to be known, and the witness of God's kingdom coming on earth as it is in heaven, that we will get a chance to witness, I am thankful and blessed. Just like that opening song that we said, God is sending us to go forth. And when I'm thankful for that knowledge, I always love to say, hallelujah, hallelujah, amen. As the band comes up, and I cough one more time, I want to invite us for a moment of discipleship. This moment of discipleship might come a couple different ways. It might say, I just want to pray alone with God. If you keep your hands close, we will give you that time. It might mean, I want to come forward and I want to pray and I want a pastor to pray with me. Please lift your hands up. It might be, I'm coming up to make a public declaration that this church is a part of the building committee of God's kingdom that I want to be a part of. Declaration can be made there. Or perhaps, I don't know exactly what Jesus is. We can talk about that and maybe make a declaration as well. But all of us have a chance to sing about what we do know, which is the goodness of God. Please stand.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness. All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, yes, I will sing of the goodness. Fire in darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I know you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. with my life laid down. I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, running after me. Your goodness is running after, running after me. Your goodness is running after, running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Those words, and you felt them in your heart, I think that's all you need to go out into the world. God is good, and if you know that to be true, please go share that. Let us go tell the truth that we already know, and it might be scary because we don't know who we're going to tell it to. We may not know when. Sometimes God asks us to do things that we don't know ahead of time, but know that he has prepared them for you already. In Jesus' name, let us go do that. Amen.
Breaking up and